So today my talk So my talk today will be about the effort of introducing design thinking at the University of Oslo Library, where I work for about 15 years. I will talk about factors for the success of design thinking, of introduction of design thinking. Also talk about how we did it, how we managed to do that. Also talk about all the intervention we had. It's about, I will not talk about all of them, it's about 20 design intervention we had. And also about the results. So this is a kind of overview of the path Alma and I had introducing design thinking in the library. We started with this need for changes, this new technology, concurring services like Google, that make very clear that the library need to change, to do something. Also because we have more demanding users, they usually use iPads or iPhones to access library services. So we need to be where the users are. And to do that, you need to understand our users, of course. So after that, we, in this path, we introduced design thinking. After that, we developed more these design methods to fit and tweak them so they fit the library in a good way. And of course, during this path, we had some question. Is the way and the things we are doing are the correct one? Is the library a better place now after we have used design thinking methods? And of course, that it's more after... after that, we had some big project about life science. And then, of course, it's not possible to change because...
Presentation.
Wrong. Oh, okay. But maybe we could try with PowerPoint. It's try with PowerPoint, maybe. Sorry for that. You can do like, okay, it's okay, let's do that way, yeah.
Where is it?
Hey! So you're so old already in my presentation. Sorry for that, okay, we try again. Yes, that's a little better. So, okay, using these methods, design methods, did we manage to bring the library in a better place? I think so. So one very good example, it's this new life science center that it's building, that it's coming in about 3 years. And about the future, okay, what's the future for our library? So first, okay, what are the factors that contribute to the success of design thinking in library? The first, of course, is this motivation to change that I was talking about, that there are things outside the library that the library need to react on, of course. The other one was about the commitment from the library to adopt these methods. Of course, openness for these design methods. And I think one of the most important thing, it's empathy for the user. Try to understand how to use library services outside the library. You need to use empathy for the user to understand how it is to use services using the mobile phone or using the iPad or the laptop at home when you are searching for library sources. Uh, Okay, also of course the leadership had commitment for this this path, and that support was cross-functional. It was across all the layer of the libraries. We found also during this commitment, we found out that also the rest of the staff were interested in participating in this change. And it's quite important to understand that we didn't made a kind of UX lab or design thinking lab or group inside the library. We made a kind of hub, a place where you could merge competence, multidisciplinary competence, from different departments, with designers, as Alma was talking about, putting designers, library staff, students, all the type of users inside this hub to make new services. Because if you made a kind of department, that UX department, also user experience department or design department inside the library, you made a kind of constraint that this group are not participating. So people outside this group want to be, are questioning, okay, why I can't be part of this group? So that was in the start the things that we observed, that you need to embrace all the stuff of the library. And one example was that outsourcing the making of app does not automatically include all the staff. So the question is, okay, what are the factors? How did we manage to innovate the library using design thinking? So as Alma introduced, we started with this cooperation with the Department of Informatics and the course of human-computer interaction, starting in 2011, but it was only incremental change. We just moved the services from the web to the mobile phone. So after that, we had more, a little more innovative, but still it was only for fun. It was not really the big radical changes. So in 2013, we had also, as Alma was showed, that we had also other incremental and innovative changes. But the real difference started in 2013. This willingness to take risks from the department was really important. We also did get a lot of fundings from the National Library of Norway, about 1 million kroner, Norwegian kroner. It's I think 3 million Czech krona. To pay, by the way, also support my PhD, but also to implement and test different services. And of course, a very good cooperation with Alma. Of course, that was, as Alma was said in the previous presentation, was really mandatory that we had a kind of legitimacy about the work we had to do. So this openness to design methods imply testing and learning and ownership of methods. Again, this with not having a kind of UX lab or design thinking lab made us possible to learn, to give this competence to all the staff of the library using this different design intervention. And also, of course, design thinking is a good way to explain to leadership about how to innovate and think as a designer. So I will talk a little bit. The first type of design intervention we had was about service design. In a way, service is the primary thing that we do for the user in the library, lending books or giving access to all the expensive resources that the library pays is one of the major things we did. So the way we did analyze these services was using this customer journey. Where the students start using our resources? Are they coming to the library at all? What about the users that are not coming to the library? How do they understand our services? So using service design, it was possible to do analysis about lending a book, this customer journey, to analyze where the contact between the user and the service provider, the library, where was our web pages or our mobile services good enough for the user that maybe have never been to the library. Also, we have a lot of international students. Do they know how the library in Norway function? So that was all the question that come out using service design. And of course, we had about 10 to 12 interventions using service design cards. From the picture, you can see this is using service design card developed by the architecture the architecture school in Oslo, where each card is a kind of touch. It's okay?
It's okay.
It's okay. Okay. Thank you. So yes, we use these cards to stand out the service design, the service that we had, for instance, lending a book, and to find out where we could redesign the touch point between the students or the researcher and the library. For instance, we find out that very often researchers do not use the web pages of the university library. So how to reach them was things that could be designed. So as we stand, as I presented before, we tweaked our design methods and using with Sumit, a colleague of Alma and I, another PhD student, who is writing about a PhD about library also. He developed a kind of new design practice and where it was more focused on open space, situated in the context of work, we see in the library, where we had very large spaces, where people could mingle, discuss, be active. And I think in regards from yesterday, from the people that was on the workshop, that the place was not so large. So that was somehow difficult to enact that kind of reconfiguration and creation of spaces. And I think spaces, it's very important to understand how these methods function. You need a lot of spaces to could discuss about problems. Yeah. So the other one, it's as Sumit point out, is proto practice. It's about the access to physical materials. So what he did, which functioned very well, are materials that are semi-structured. So using tools and methods that are not so constrained, that allow people to adopt to their ways of work, was really important. And it showed that it functioned well. So not so, as I say here, not template without material or stylistics constraint and specific instruction. And that worked very well in about 10 design intervention we had with this method. The other ones, I can say about this, maybe the difference between this and the service design card, that the service design card somehow gives a kind of constraint. Here it was more easier to adopt to the different type of services of the library and of course of the staff. So the last part of this method from Sumit was about problem identification. Also again here, semi-structured outcome and also semi-structured methods that was not so constrained. And you see here, it's a kind of user journey also, but you don't use cards. You let the user create each touch points. So you can say, to understand this proto-practice from Sumit Pandey, it's that you adopt the practice of the library and with these design methods as a proto-practice, and allow to merge with methods using in the library, so they can use when maybe they are in a group meeting or they have a project, they can adopt these methods more to them. It showed that it was easier to take in use. So this is, of course, have a continuous evolution. So these methods, it doesn't stop somehow. It will evolve all during, you more people use it, you more it will evolve. So we can also have another perspective about these two methods that I was, design methods I was presenting. The one is about this language, this design language. When designer are designing, they have a kind of language. And that kind of language to communicate the meaning of the design sometimes can be alienating the library staff. So using these methods, we are trying to make a kind of dialogical space that enable communication between designer and library staff to make their own kind of language, so it adopts the task of the library. And it's based on Kippendorf. I don't know if it's a kind of theory, semantic turn. So interventions. This is kind of timeline. This is only few of those. The science library, our own digital service departments, a website that was redesigned several times using these methods, called PhD and Track, which is a support for PhD students. The law libraries and the Teptunis project, I will talk a little bit about that later. The web editor group, the life science, that also was really interesting, and the Enable project with Uganda. I will show a little bit more on those. Here it's, for instance, using the service design card in the law library. And you see that even, okay, there was somehow a quite a difference between this method and the other proto-practice methods, but also these methods allow users to create their own kind of services and dialogical spaces. The other one is the Teptunis project. This is using still the service design card. And this was a cooperation between the University of Oslo Library, Berkeley University, the Bancroft Library, and the University of Padua. And the interesting part of this project was the cooperation between the multidisciplinarity. We used architects, we used designers, technical experts about scannings, we used library staff, subject librarians, and also professors. So this was a really fruitful workshop. So we had workshop both in the US, in Italy, and two in Norway. And the outcome is a lot of new ideas for representing the Teptunis site in Egypt, where people found a lot of papyrus. So the idea was to combine information about papyrus, publications, excavations, flight photos, for instance, and combine and make a services not only for the researcher but also for the layman. And of course, during this workshop, we had solution that allowed to allow the layman participate. Maybe you have person that are working with papyrus in other part of the world that want to contribute to this service. So in this way, we had a very holistic analysis. And of course, the interesting part was that the library was the central part of this service, the central promoter. The other project called Enable was with at university library in Uganda, Kiambogo. So we was there and helping them using design thinking methods. And then also we invited them to the University of Oslo and helped them to make new services for master students. And we see also that this method function well also for them in Uganda. So this is, we use the giga mapping methods. And they are in fact implementing some of the results now. Okay, the other thing that I want to talk about, it's this life science building project. And it's about what kind of competitive advantage this method was for our staff. In the beginning of this life science building, the department said, okay, we don't need library because it's science. So we have everything online. So we invited all the the chief of this different department of life science, biology, chemistry, some from law and medicine, and help them to redesign the first floor of this building. Because the goal of the life science was to have innovation in the first floor. So that was one of the premises from the government that, okay, we give you the money for this very expensive building, the largest in North Scandinavia, North Europe, but you have to have innovation. So using these design methods, we managed to complete change the perspective of the participant. So in fact, now the library will be in charge of the first floor of this building, enabling creativity, innovation, 3D labs, and places where the researcher can test the ideas they have. So this was using these methods really, really a competitive advantage, and to bring the library in a new position with new services. But also, of course, it was about fundings, because with these methods, of course, building, of course, it also come a lot of fundings, because you have to have staff and infrastructure for this part. For the library's management, it was also very important to use design thinking, because they found out at the end that it was making a lot of the process inside the library much easier. For instance, in the web group now, before it was very difficult to be a web editor of the University of Oslo library. You had a lot of people that was deciding, I have to have this information on the website, this is important, this is important for me. Now, using this design thinking methods with empathy for the user, we managed to make this process much easier. Because what we do that we go out and test some of the solutions, some of the ideas the subject librarian want on the web page, and we can show that, okay, this idea is good, but this other ones doesn't function. So this make also the process of working in the library much easier. But of course, sometimes it could be difficult to measure the real also effects of money. Yes, of course, strategical now, also with the help of my supervisor Alma, we had a lot of interest in the library from other departments of the university. So they were really interested to cooperate with us. We have also this product designer that is not only doing the PhD, but also working inside the library. And now it's one from the Netherlands. It's a special UX designer for visualization. It will join us for a year or two in digital services. So we can say that this design thinking method had made us ready for the future. So concluding, so giving the staff the semi-structured design methods help them rethink the roles the library staff have when they're giving the services. And of course, a better understanding, this empathy was central, and allow innovation of services. Thank you.